It is surprisingly hard to own a recipe. I mean, legally own it, to the point where if somebody without your permission copied your recipe or marketed your recipe, you could sue them and win. It's possible, but it is surprisingly hard when one considers the script I'm writing this instant is immediately covered by internationally recognized copyright protections as it leaves my fingertips. As it leaves my mouth and goes into the camera, I instantaneously own the copyright on the thing that I am creating right now. So why wouldn't I instantaneously own a recipe I come up with? Well, in a way, I do. I own the copyright to this, the specific wording with which I expressed my recipe, if you believe that my instructional prose qualifies as some kind of literary work.
Copyright typically relates to things like literary works, music, drama, and computer programs.
This is Dr. Laura Clues, doctor of chemistry and an attorney at Mathis and Squire, which is a big European intellectual property law firm. And while her expertise is mostly in UK and EU law, these broad strokes of intellectual property law have been very internationalized via trade agreement. So pretty much everything we're about to say is the law pretty much everywhere. Pretty much everywhere copyright, for example, refers to media or applies to media, creative works, artistic works, music, paintings, videos.
And can be used to prevent other people from performing those works or providing copies and selling copies and things like that. But unfortunately, copyright doesn't extend to statements of mere fact or ideas or methods of operation.
Indeed, if we look at this circular from the United States Copyright Office, quote, "The office cannot register recipes consisting of a set of ingredients and a process for preparing a dish. In contrast, a recipe that creatively explains or depicts how or why to perform a particular activity may be copyrightable." At that point, the recipe would go beyond just being a simple utilitarian object and actually become a work of art, of literature. Like, Chrissy Teigen isn't just a terrific developer of recipes. She's a terrific writer, and her authorial voice crackles through all of her cookbook prose. But it's the prose and the beautiful photos and such that are copyrighted, not the dishes themselves. You can't copyright concepts or ideas. But you can patent some ideas, and that's what Dr. Clues does. She's a patent attorney, where no doubt her chemistry background comes in handy. You almost always need a patent attorney if you want to apply for a patent, because a patent is a thing you actually have to apply for, as opposed to copyright, which you own automatically. The second a creative idea, piece of content, leaves your brain and goes to the page, you own the copyright. You can get some extra protection by actively registering a copyright, but that's a bonus. It's not a must. To get a patent, you must fill out some pretty long and complicated forms. You have to demonstrate three things. Your idea is inventive, it is novel, and industrially applicable. And we have a word for an idea like that, right? It's called an invention. And certainly a recipe could be an invention that qualifies for protection under patent law. Just as you can protect your digital life with the sponsor of this video, Surfshark, whom I'll now briefly thank. Surfshark is simply all the tools most people can need to stay safe on the internet and to surf freely. At its core, it's a virtual private network, VPN. You do the one-touch connect, and then it's a lot harder for criminals or big companies to spy on you. But more than that, it allows you to obscure your physical location, for example. Very useful when overcoming internet censorship in many countries, accessing websites or apps that might simply be blocked in your country or your network. It allows you to get around price discrimination. Some companies will charge you differently depending on where you are. Lots of streaming services won't stream certain stuff to certain countries, even if you're entitled to it. Surfshark can route you through their servers in any country that you need, and then you can watch what you want to watch. There's additional tools for doing anonymous searching and browsing, for blocking pop-ups, all kinds of things. Surfshark is unlimited, and you can get 83% off it if you hit my link in the description and use my promo code AdamRagusia, all one word. 83% off Surfshark plus an additional 3 months for free. Link and code are in the description. Thank you, Surfshark. Now, to protect a recipe under patent law, you have to demonstrate that it is novel, industrially applicable, and inventive. What is inventive?
For inventive, you need to show that it's not obvious. So this can be a little bit more tricky to understand. So we normally say, if you have a particular unexpected technical effect associated with either, say, a specific ingredient that you've used or a specific process step.
So, for example, in 2006, J. Kenji Lopez-Alt had just been hired as a test cook at Cook's Illustrated magazine, and he came up with a new way to cook steak. Instead of searing the outside and then gradually cooking the inside, Kenji flipped the script. You very slowly bring the interior of the steak to the exact temperature you want, and then you blast the outside. It's a method that's particularly good for very thick steaks, and it seems conceivable to me that Kenji's idea there might have qualified as inventive by the standards of patent law. I mean, obviously he probably wouldn't have owned it because he was on the job when he came up with that idea. Cook's Illustrated would have owned it. But let's just stay with the thought experiment for the moment. Let's assume that Kenji's idea there, the reverse sear, was inventive by the standards of patent law. Surely it's also industrially applicable. Reverse searing can be great in a restaurant setting when you're trying to expedite things. You do the slow cook stage in advance and then simply sear the steak to order. Kenji could have launched a whole worldwide chain of fast, fine steakhouses where you order a $100 steak and have it prepared in less time than it takes to fold a burrito. But was Kenji's idea novel?
So the requirement of novel just means that it hasn't been disclosed anywhere in the world before the date that you filed your patent application.
As they say, great minds think alike, and great ideas, even when they're not obvious ones, tend to be arrived at independently by multiple people when that idea's time has come. This is a phenomenon known as multiple discovery or simultaneous invention. Classic example is the American Thomas Edison and Brit Joseph Swan both inventing the incandescent light bulb totally on their own, working on parallel tracks. They both patented their inventions in their respective countries in 1879. Of course, they sorted it out, merged their companies, and the rest is history. In our friend Kenji's case, I obviously believe him when he says that he independently invented the reverse sear. He had not heard about that from anywhere else when he came up with the idea for himself. But his idea was not novel, for a few reasons, which Kenji recently discussed over on his excellent YouTube channel.
In the period since we published that in 2007, some people have brought it to my attention, mainly Meathead over at AmazingRibs.com, where you can find a full history of the reverse sear. It was brought to my attention that a guy named Chris Finney was for, I think it was the barbecue team is called Iron Pig Barbecue, but he was writing on barbecue forums about doing the reverse sear a couple years before I published it in Cook's Illustrated. So
not novel. And indeed, AmazingRibs.com documents reverse searing that actually predates Finney. Of course, it's moot because Kenji didn't try to patent the reverse sear in the first place. Dr. Clues is not aware of any instance in which a restaurant chef or a food media personality tried to patent a recipe. Generally, this is done by the food manufacturing industry, dealing with pretty esoteric stuff.
For example, Nestle have come up with a process for producing hollowed out crystal sugar crystal. And in that way, you think that you're getting the same amount of sugar, but in reality, the sugar content of the chocolate bar, say, is a lot lower.
And you can go online right now and see multiple patent applications pertaining to different arcane technical components of that invention. Patent applications become legally public documents generally 18 months after you file them. And in those documents, Nestle spills all their secrets. In exhaustive detail, they tell you exactly how to reproduce their inventions because they have to if they want patent protection. If I'm granted a patent for my invention, I then have an exclusive legal monopoly to market that invention. And then for you to be reasonably expected to be able to comply with the law, you have to be able to know exactly what my invention is, right? You have to know what you're not allowed to do in order to follow the law. So that's why I have to spill the beans in my patent application. But that's fine, because if I'm granted my patent, I then have the exclusive right to market that invention, even if you know what it is. But not forever. There is the rub with patent law. Patents generally only last 20 years, and you can't re-up them like you can with copyright. Here's a classic example. The recipe for Coca-Cola has got to be one of the most closely guarded secrets in commercial history. If John Pemberton had patented his formula for Coca-Cola when he invented it in 1886, his recipe would have become a public document in the form of his patent application, and then in 1906, when the patent expired, anyone would have been free to copy the recipe right out of that application and then to sell their own drink that tasted exactly like Coke. The Coke formula would be on the US Patent Office website right now, but Pemberton didn't do that, so it's not. The function of patent law is to give you a chance to get established in the market with your new invention. It's not to give you an exclusive monopoly in perpetuity. Nonetheless, Coca-Cola has maintained that monopoly for well over 100 years now. There's tons of generic colas, but none of them taste exactly like Coke, because instead of going the patent route, Coca-Cola went the trade secret route. The law will actually help you protect your trade secrets if you have taken reasonable steps to protect them.
Say, password protecting files, if you limit the number of people who have access to that information, you can have confidentiality agreements in employment contracts. You can show that you've made sure you've educated your employees on how to handle confidential information and why it's important. And obviously, try not to disclose it to third parties, but if you do, you need to make sure that you've got non-disclosure agreements in place.
So say you did all of that, but your secret recipe leaks anyway. You would be able to sic your lawyer, obviously on the leaker, and potentially also on anybody who tried to market your recipe, even if they weren't involved in stealing or leaking the recipe. What trade secrets don't protect you from is anybody, say, looking at that list of ingredients you're legally required to put on the label, and then maybe taking a little sample back to the lab to figure out in what quantities you have those ingredients and how you combined them.
So essentially they reverse engineer what you've done. You can't prevent that third party from continuing to make that product or use that process. In addition, if a third party independently comes up with the same products or process, there's nothing that you can do to prevent them continuing in that business.
But of course, even if somebody reverse engineered Coke, they couldn't sell it as Coke. The name Coke and the logo here are trademarked. That's what that little R is. And trademarks are infinitely renewable because their only function is to prevent confusion and deceit in the marketplace. To make it so that no company could trick consumers into believing they were buying something from somebody else. So in that sense, trademark law is kind of inapplicable to our present discussion, right? The name of your recipe is not your recipe. But maybe the shape is?
Toblerone were successful in this. So they actually have a registered trademark for the triangular chocolate shape that they have, which means that obviously that's being generated as part of their process of making the chocolate. But they're able to prevent other companies from producing the same shape in the form of a chocolate bar.
Dessert frequently runs into issues of intellectual property law because it's so readily decorated. People put trademarked and copyrighted art on cookies and cakes all the time, often illicitly, though not in this case. These have my permission and they're beautiful. Another thing is that food itself can be art, right? When a sculptor works in clay, they instantaneously own the copyright to their work. Why should molding in flour or sugar be any different? You gotta wonder if somebody, probably not me, somebody better at the stuff than me, you gotta wonder if somebody might make a legally persuasive argument that their recipe transcends the level of mere utilitarian consumable good and is indeed art. Art that is copied every time the recipe is prepared. The same way that a musical composition is copied or reproduced when somebody covers it. Dr. Kluse says that'd be a pretty tough legal argument to make about food in court, but she says it's not inconceivable. Of course, this entire legal discussion is totally apart from the discussion of ethics, right? Just because you can nick someone's recipe doesn't mean you should. But that's a different conversation, and one we'll have another day.